Hello there. My name is Dr. Anton Jessup, curator of monster studies here at the university. I'm currently prohibited from teaching due to the ongoing investigation into the Voral girl's disappearance. So in the meantime, I must turn to this exciting VHS technology in order to educate the masses. It's curious. These tapes allow us to glimpse creatures that otherwise thwart the human optical ability or even the optical properties of mirrors. Which brings us to the amazing anatomy of the humanoid vampire. When it comes to vampiric humanoids, we place far too much emphasis on viral infections and supernatural curses, because at heart we have something far more fascinating, a humanoid sanguivore. And an obligate sanguivore at that, which is to say an organism that depends on blood exclusively. Forget those sexy goth blood drinkers and daywalking glitter vamps. This nocturnal creature comes for you in your sleep, at your most vulnerable. Stealth is its greatest attribute, and your vital fluids are all it desires. The vampire's body is emaciated to the point of starvation, for blood is hardly a font of necessary nutrients. It's just protein and water. There's no fat for the vampire to store away, and nothing to sustain it for prolonged periods of activity, or even non-activity. Don't believe what they say. There's very little power in the blood. It's just like the vampire bat of the natural world. Unlike its fruit and insect goblin kin, it cannot hibernate or migrate because it lacks the fat stores to do so. So instead, it must lap up 50% of its own body weight each and every night. The humanoid vampire creeps on top of you as you slumber. Oh, you don't feel its bony body pressing against your own because it does everything in its power to avoid your arousal. It just licks your neck with a strange grooved tongue and then slices in with a specialized tooth. Oh, it's not much of a wound. Really, it should stop bleeding in a mere couple of minutes. Except the Nosferatu saliva, like that of the vampire bat, is a complex cocktail of anticoagulants. You'll keep bleeding for hours. And the Nosferatu certainly doesn't suck. Like the vampire bat, our ghastly humanoid sanguivore uses the piston-like motion of its tongue to make blood flow into its mouth. It trickles in along a pair of grooves on the bottom of the tongue and in through a special cleft in the lip. And do you feel wet all of a sudden? Well, that's because your vampiric visitor begins to urinate shortly after that first taste. So now an increasingly potent stream of blood urine washes over your legs, because like the vampire bat, it must excrete all excess water weight as soon as possible, to say nothing of waste toxicity. And so the vampire bat lives in a constant threat of dehydration. It must stick to moist climates, for it lives in a constant physiology-induced desert, no matter how tropical its surroundings. At last, the creature leaves you drained in your urine-soaked bed. It's off to find other sleepers in the night. And if you wake at all the next morning, you'll likely ponder how such a strange organism came to be. The answer remains lost in the mists of prehistory, but scientists have a hypothesis or two. Perhaps their first taste of blood came from communal grooming, the delicious pop of a blood-gorged parasite between their jaws. Or perhaps they adapted to depend on the ticks and fleas of large prehistoric mammals before finally cutting out the middleman and sinking in their teeth. Another hypothesis suggests they dined at the gaping wounds of megafauna, feasting on insects and wriggling larva, and occasionally the salty sweet blood of the host itself. So imagine some impossible prehistoric age. See these naked humanoids as they scale the flanks of this mist-walking behemoth. See them leap and bite at the blood-gorged parasites. It's the beginning of a long, dark banquet. Oh, Maxwell, your supper's ready, and if you would, in transmission.